It's interesting to note that images don't seem to do much for anybody anymore, and the viewers prefer me to be on camera rather than giving some images of various teachers. And I had this the heads up on this today. Someone gave talking about it, talking about something that related to this, and I realized, wow, it's just something about right now. We want someone here now, right? Doesn't matter what was in the past. I'm so I'm going to try to do more, on camera. Keep going with that. Let me adjust this a little bit. It's been a very difficult day, very trying day, very intense day. But everything's fine. I took a rest. We're getting to the nitty-gritty right now. Really getting to the nitty-gritty. And just the pressure is just like we're in a pressure cooker right now. I spoke with someone today, just happened to conversation. They voiced what I feel everyone is feeling. And that there's no way to fix what's going on in the world at all. There's no way to fix it. And people are just saying, what do we do? 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 And looking at pictures of a great spiritual teacher doesn't seem to be enough for us. It just does not. So what do we do? What do we do? Well, God has a plan. God has a plan. We know God has a plan, and so we will find out. I also got a heads up on maybe an idea of what to do in a small scale. Small scale. Don't tackle really big projects. It's not going to be some big events. It's going to be like grassroots, small scale grassroots type of situation taking place. This is my intuition. So I'm getting there. I'm getting there. Hopefully I'll get there soon. And where is there? Getting nowhere. It's the acceptance of nowhere to get to. That's the key. And what we can talk about here after we've gone through this little intro of heads up here, heads up, something's brewing. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. I've spoken of the difference between the gradualist path and the all-at-once path. This is something throughout history that's been going on. And I can speak at length about it, but let's condense it all down and just say this. The best way to look at it is this way, is the gradual path is still saying that there's some explanation that can satisfy absurdity. You just got to find this explanation. The all-at-once path is the recognition that there is no explanation whatsoever. There's nothing that can be explained or said at all that will satisfy absurdity. It will remain inherently neurotically paranoid. Okay. There is nothing that we can ever say about it. And then recognizing this is called repentance. And then you shift from gradualist path to all-at-once path, where you shift from trying to ripen the fruit to realizing the fruit is already ripe. It's already ripe. So realizing the fruit's already ripe, that puts you in a whole different frame of mind. It puts you in the wow frame of mind. Whereas the gradualist path, you keep dodging the wow. You keep seeking for an explanation that will satisfy absurdity. So this kind of reduces the whole historical gambit of this, of the past and all this. It just reduces to a very simple explanation here. And so what we do is we're reaching out to those on the all-at-once path, where those who realize the fruit's already ripe. It's always been ripe. Wow. Quite shocking. It fundamentally changes our outlook and our way of looking at our mind and how we use our time. All of that changes. Jesus said, you hear this over and over, repent, repent, repent. You must repent. No one enters the kingdom of heaven without repenting. You must repent first. It's absolutely so. You must, trying to ripen the fruit is trying to find an explanation for that absurdity will accept and say, oh yeah, now I understand. Of course, absurdity's hope is that once it understands, it says, oh, I'm not absurd. I mean, I understand. See, I'm not absurd. Now I can define God. Now I understand what the definition of God is. So I'm not absurd anymore. So it's the cure for absurdity is to believe, to give absurdity a clear explanation. And the absurdity we're engaged in is really trying to define God, which is absolute perfect freedom, all-inclusiveness, perfect freedom. There's nothing to grasp. There's no explanation to give, actually. It's absurd to expect one. So we have this expectation, absurd expectation, arrogant, absurd expectation. And we think gradually, we can gradually, somehow time will enable absurdity to finally get it. That's the gradualist path. The all-at-once path is realize that that will never happen. It's already impossible, right now. And we view, again, this really puts a different spin on your life and on your inquiry, your path, everything. And the best way is to sit quietly when you hear this, and the wow. You really have to. So that all at once path can go rather quickly. It's somewhat stressful for sure. Now, I was asked today, I was having a conversation, and they said, what do we do? I mean, there's almost guaranteed to be just turmoil coming up from all directions, guaranteed. Whether you look at it statistically, academically, or just empiric evidence of assessment, observation, or with spiritual intuition, you know, however you look at it, you say that the probability is very high. So the good news is when you're on this path of sudden enlightenment, you're not really interested in the turmoil. You have enough of your own turmoil to deal with in terms of, wow, the fruit's already ripe. What do I do? What do I do? I have to eat it. I can't postpone it. You know, it's absurd to postpone it. What is going on? So you have a center. Your spiritual practice becomes your center. That is your centering. You're able to center this way because it's all important to you. It's very important. Whereas a gradualist path, they can still dabble in dilettantes. You know, you still pay attention to politics and sports and social this and gossip and the whole movies. It's amazing. People just seem to come up to me and I'll just start talking out of the blue. You know, it's just, and they blah, 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 blah. And they say, you know, a lot of people who are not, the people who are not on the spiritual path, you know how they spend their time? Walking their dog and watching movies. This is true. Walking their dog, our dogs, and watching movies. And they just try to fill up all their time with this. It's amazing. They're thinking, maybe if I dumb myself down, that'll work. You're thinking, maybe absurdity is, you know, I need to dumb it down. Whatever. But, so, you're going to have this very big divide in the world of those who really, really get on the sudden path to enlightenment, that it's all at once path, all at once, and those who say, well, you know, maybe I can make some gradual improvements, but meanwhile, and then they're going to get pulled into all the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, the dogs, the movies, you know, self-medicating, just trying to keep their minds together, you know, and try to find some solace somewhere. But those on the path, they find solace in the practice and the discipline. It's powerful. Because you're able to just push everything away, and the grace of God is with you so strongly that even when you want to fail, God won't let you fail. This is what I've been finding out. I keep wanting to do things, and God keeps stepping in the way, saying, no, I don't want you to do that. I told you that's not right. I said, oh, you're right. Yeah, you're right. Okay. And I graciously accept it. So the grace of God is potently with you when you're on this all-at-once path. You don't have to label it anything in particular. It's just a sudden path of sudden enlightenment. The fruit's already ripe. It's already there. And so we look at absurdity. And one thing I saw today was one of the mistakes we're making is we're looking for some middle ground between. We know that good absurdity and bad absurdity is equally absurd. We've gone through that. And we can get that. But we're making a further mistake. We're saying, okay, let me find the middle ground between the good and the bad absurdity. As if that's the middle path or something, the middle ground. Okay, so let me fixate in the now of between good and bad absurdity. No, that's still absurdity. There is no place to abide in absurdity. There is no place at all. And furthermore, there's nowhere to abide in when you think, well, what can I abide in? It's not abiding in anything. It's just abidance. Abidance itself is all there is. It's not I'm abiding in all there is. I am all that there is. Abidance is that. Abidance is that. So it's nothing that absurdity can understand at all. Okay, absurdity cannot understand at all. Understanding never works. And reality doesn't need any understanding, that's for sure. It is. So all this produces a great intensity in us. And it takes this discipline of sitting quietly and just being impacted by this. Very sobering. And I can feel the wow rising in me right now. Absolutely. It's not abidance in anything. Okay? It's not abidance in anything. It's abidance. Abidance is the form of everything. So I advise everyone to take it very seriously. The unrepentant mind is always asking questions. The repentant mind is not asking questions, really. Because they find the teaching. It's boom. I mean, it's just like it just hits so hard. It's just wow. So I don't really have to ask questions. You can just look, and it just spontaneously arises. You just see, oh my gosh, you know, this is the mistake I've been making. So it's an internal path that just arises from your dedication, from your repentance. The grace is the path. It's a path of grace. You feel you're in this path of grace where everything just keeps unfolding and you just have to hang on as a passenger almost. And just, wow, look at this landscape I'm seeing now. Clearing up here in California, Bay Area. Supposed to get like four days of real nice spring weather coming up. Tomorrow's the Ides of March. Probably when you're watching this, Ides of March. Now, it's very important going forward that we don't mix up the two paths, and we recognize where are we at? Have we repented? Meaning, we see the impossibility of absurdity. We see that perfect. We know perfection's already perfect. We know there's just this trick, and there's nothing we need to do. We need just evaporate the continuity fear. There's nothing we have to improve upon, or you know, like character-wise, or do anything. It's just a whole different focus. It comes from glimpses of truth. It comes from glimpses of truth. So we have to be committed to this path. Now, the commitment to this path of no path, really, it's that we're already here. We're already abiding. We're already abidance. We just have to stop denying this. Stop pretending otherwise. So commit to this and be serious about it. And this... this then provides this it provides a center for you, a focus, a purpose, something to organize your life around, your habits around. So good habits spring from this, from this path of grace. All these good habits spring forth. And you develop these good habits just automatically. Because this is what's all important to you. You're being challenged. It's all important to you. You're being challenged. That I can't escape, you know, that reality is inescapable. Completely inescapable. I'm already there. I'm already that. Sargadatta Maharaj said, I am that. Yeah, I am that. I'm already that. I can be that. I will be that. I'm already that. So I can be that is the gradual approach. I will be that is the well, they're both. It is I can be that gradualist. I will be that is sort of transferring from gradualism to all at once, and then I'm already that is the all at once approach. There's certainly some scattered here and there that are most definitely doing that approach. Some non-dual, you know, non-dual, some people call it non-dual, but it's, you don't have to call it that at all. It's just repent and practice. Follow the grace of your practicing, follow the grace of your focus here. Walk in the wow, practice this full stop in the wow, be very serious about it. Because turmoil is coming from all directions. Now, this the conversation I had today, who I was speaking with said, you know, it would almost be better if it just all melted down. I said, yeah, I mean, that's true. It would give everyone a chance to refocus, right? I mean, the situation is just not fixable. And so there's likely to be a huge meltdown And we need then out of that, we need what's called repentance, is we realize that this gradualist approach of trying to fix absurdity doesn't work. And there's no middle ground in absurdity. There's no middle ground to find. This is just like a kaboom to hear this. There is no middle ground to find. There is no polarity to find. There's no polarity and there's no middle ground at all. All of absurdity is equally absurd. It's just completely flat. There's no definition of God. So how can we draw distinctions when we're trying to define God? How can we say we can draw distinctions? That's absurdity. That's the root of absurdity. There are no distinctions to be drawn. So I'm under pressure to you know, realize this and start helping out. And I say, well, why don't you let Ramana help you out? And people say, no. we want something, you know, better. I don't know, it's not better, but they want something that's walking and talking and moving around right now. Of course, Ramana is present. All these teachers are present, but you don't come to ask questions at all. This is completely wrong focused. I was speaking with this surfer a couple of weeks ago. I was watching him. He was actually in the video. This wonderful man, and he came in. And I said, hi. How was it? I said, it's tough to get out. Right? It's just brutally difficult. The sets are so close together. It's just, and we talked about it. And he said, you know, I know that right now I can't get out, but I enjoy the intensity of it, he says. I enjoy the intensity of it. It's so intense. It's fun. It's just being out there is fun. I said, wow, interesting. I can relate to that. So, we may not be enlightened right this instant. We're already enlightened, actually. We may not drop our pretense this instant. But we can get out in the ocean and just feel the intensity. Feel the intensity. Wow. Be part of that. So he was game. You know, he was game. And you keep going out enough like that, you get stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger, and then someday you do get out where the waves are. So he wasn't asking questions. How do I get out? He said, I'm just out here paddling. I'm going through the white water. I've been feeling the currents. I'm feeling the ocean. I'm hearing it, the roar. I mean, the action, everything. I totally understood what he was saying, because I used to do that too. And I had times where I couldn't get out at all and just got beat to pieces. But it was like afterwards, I just say, oh my, that was really very, very amazing and very intense. What an experience. And maybe it was better than even getting out. It was really quite extraordinary. So you don't come to an ocean like this thinking, oh, okay, well, how do I ride the waves? All this technical information, how am I going to ride the waves? You're not even going to get out, you know. But so you just have to immerse yourself in the intensity of it. And just feel the intensity. That's it. Just feeling the intensity of it. Not manufacturing intensity. Full stop in the wild. You're not trying to manufacture anything. But you're just feeling the intensity of it. And words are just conversation, it don't mean anything actually. Basically, all you're hearing is reassured. Yeah, you're already home. You are abidance. There's not a Bidens as this or as this or as that or anywhere particularly. Well, you just are Bidens. We are Bidens. Everywhere and nowhere. Nothing and everything. And neither in both of those. We isness just is. There's just this one isness. So talking is just like talking about the weather, you know. It's just, yeah, it's nice, but we're feeling, getting used to the intensity. This is what is key. This is really the path, is you get used to the intensity of it. But don't substitute something for this intensity. Don't try to substitute. So you know, really, just that doesn't work. The sex, drugs, rock and roll way doesn't work. Doesn't work. Very bad paths. I think, oh, this is really intense. You have to get used to the intensity that you already know the truth. You are Bidens, and it's being pointed out, and you're seeing it. You have to see it. That's the intensity. Is you start glimpsing it, and your mind says, oh, I recognize. Oh my gosh, I'm capable of recognizing it. Oh my gosh. It's this immediacy of recognition that brings the intensity. You just can't put your body through some sort of intense ordeal and think that's the spiritual path. It's not. It's not. It gets nowhere. That's still locked, spinning wheels and gradualism. You have to see there is no middle ground. There's no polarity. There's no middle ground. I saw this today. It's just wow. Nothing to do about it. There's nothing you could do. It's a full stop in the wow. This just, you know, shifts, huge fundamental landscape shift. Now, when we say silent, silent, quiet, it means you're just holding the intensity. You're just feeling the intensity. That's all. You're allowing yourself to feel the intensity, to feel the wow. And you're not, don't need to say anything about it. That's not a full stop in the wow. It's just, the bell has been rung, and it's just, you just, it's still, it's reverberating. And so you just keep your mind from reacting to it. Don't react to it. Lump all reactions into just the wow. Lump all gradualism into just the wow. This is one way of how do you get free of gradualism. Lump everything, all of gradualism, is just into this one wow reaction, and that's it. And just full stop in the wow, like this. It's not really anguish. That's why I call it wow. It's just wow, wowness. It's sort of, it's just all the reactions lumped into one. Don't dissect it. Don't dissect it. Don't analyze it. Don't try to organize it. Don't think about it. Don't try to recall how you got it. Don't try to imagine what you're going to do with it. Don't try to find the middle ground in it. Don't try to find the polarity in the middle ground in it. So the once one repents, the path is very intense. We have to manage our success on it. You don't feel like socializing either. When you're feeling this, you don't feel like socializing. So it's like, you know, tea and cookies and chit-chat afterwards. No, no way. You just feel like you're walking in a different world, actually. Because the inner landscape has changed. It absolutely has. It's like a massive earthquake has happened. So it's not a social scene at all. It's not a social scene. There's no social scene really around it. There's the mutual respect for those who are going through this, but it's not a social scene. It's more of a monastic type of situation where you after this massive upheaval, just, wow, I just have to take it easy here and concentrate on just this full stop mode. There's no middle ground anywhere. Therefore, we can give up the notion of the ground. There is no ground. There's no ground, and there's no middle ground. There's not this ground and that ground and then a middle ground. There's just abidance. There's just isness. So questions don't need to be asked at all, because the pointers are easy to point out, and this will trigger. You just have to be prepared to have this trigger, you know, the wow. All you have to do is be willing, say, I'm committed to full stop in the wow, and that commitment itself is going to bring the insight that you need. And it's going to hit hard. Because you're ready. See, that's what I want. Every day I say, come on, bring it. I'm ready. Bring it, bring it, bring it, bring it, bring it. Live for the wow. I live for the wow. Take off on I live for the sun. I live for the wow. Is going to be triggered every day. So you don't have to worry about that. You don't have to worry about asking questions. Don't be in your questioning mind at all. Don't be in your the questioning mind. Drop it. It's too late for that. You've already repented. You realize that's futile. That's absurdity. And you're trying to, absurdity goes to teachers and say, see, absurdity is the belief, our belief, our presumption, arrogant presumption that we're greater than God, which for us means God is definable. We're not definable, but God is definable. So we're looking for a definition of God, and we feel our insecurity, and it's really a great paranoia that those who have not repented have a tremendous, terrible paranoia that can be triggered and eventually gets triggered, which is why we have all the turmoil in the world throughout history. The idea of bringing peace to this world is ridiculous. It's completely ridiculous. Those who are simply realize that they are abidance itself don't even need the world. They'll soon realize it's not even needed at all. And those who have not repented have this terrible paranoia. And how could you bring peace when everyone is harboring this hideous paranoia of being thrust into an abyss of non-definition? They view non-definition as annihilation. So what absurdity is saying they go to a teacher and say, okay, you must have, you're peaceful, you have peace of mind, no paranoia, great, you must have found the right definition of God. This is what they believe. This is what. So you have all these people, call them people, but you have these spirits Search seeking. Seeking. They're seekers. When you repent, you're not a seeker anymore. You're not a seeker anymore. You already know the answer. Wow. You just have to get used to it. There's no more seeking, really. But the absurdity is always seeking. A seeking what it, the right definition of God. The definition of God that will take away its paranoia and say, oh yes, God really is definable. So I don't have to worry about the abyss of non-definition. This is what absurdity is after. And so we'll go to the teachers and ask teachers questions. And really, they're just saying, what they're really saying is, teacher, I know you know the definition, but what do I have to do to get it? You know, can I get it by asking this question? Can I get it by worshiping you? Can I get it by this? Can I get it by that? And there's just this desperate hope that they think the teacher has the answer, the definition of God, but they're just reluctant to say what it is, or you got to do something, you know, to win their grace or something. No, the answer is there isn't any definition. There isn't any. But absurdity refuses to believe this. It refuses to believe this. It says, no, you're holding it back from me. How much do you want? How much do you want? What do you need? What do you need? What do you need? I'll get whatever you need. Just give it to me. There isn't any. Teacher just realized that non-definition is not an abyss at all. It's abidance. So those who have repented, they go to the teacher and they say, basically, I already know the answer. And the teacher says, absolutely, you do. They say, yeah, but what's the problem then? Well, continuity fear is the problem. Basically, you have to evaporate it. You have to evaporate it. So you just try to evaporate as fast as possible, but you have to be judicious and dedicated and get your rest. You know, you'll have ups and downs, how it goes. Someone asked Punjaji, what's the fastest path? He said, just be quiet. Just sit there. Just be quiet. Because he knew he could point out easily. Just point out. Basically, you already know. You already know the truth. You already know it. You just have to get used to it and realize, accept it. And this continuity fear has to gradually evaporate. But it evaporates fastest when you sit there quietly in this intensity, feeling this intensity. Not like, oh, I'm trying to feel grace, or I'm trying. No, it's the wow is what you're feeling. It's a combination of elation and trepidation, really. It's sort of all gradualism rolled into one, and you realize, I don't need any of that. Wow, is what do I do with this? Wow, you know, what do I do with all my efforts? Everything, all my absurdity is just all one, just big wow now. It's all rolled into one. And ultimately, you realize you don't even need the wow. But it feels like an ordeal, really. It's almost like you're almost gasping for breath. And not literally, I always breathe smoothly and calmly. But just beneath that, in the psyche, there's this reverberation taking place. It's just shaking. Sometimes it comes through a little bit, but it doesn't have to. Don't act it out. This is just grandstanding. That's not full stop in the wow. It's like when you've had some very intense close call in some way, and everything's fine. So you're breathing fine, everything's fine, but inside you also feel a shakiness. Like there's a group and they're being selected, and everyone's name is being called, and your name hasn't been called yet, and you think, I've been left out. I've been left out. Oh my gosh. This happened to me once. There were all these prizes. Everybody picked a number, and then they called all these numbers off, and everyone was getting prizes. It's extraordinary. And so they went through everything, I thought, and my number hadn't been called. I was the only one who hadn't been called. I was just like, wow, I'm forsaken. You know, I'm just, everybody overlooks me. I'm forsaken. I was just, it was really difficult to take. I said, again, it's happened again. This is my life. And then they said, oh, okay. Almost forgot whatever they said. But they said, we do have one more prize, and it's actually the grand prize. The grand gift. We saved it for last year. And I started thinking, wow. And then they called the number was my number. And so I got this grand prize. It was really exceptional. It was just extraordinary. But so I was so happy, but I was still shaken from the trauma of like, maybe I'm being overlooked. Maybe I'm being overlooked. So we think that maybe God has overlooked us. And even when we realize, no, this is not true, the shakiness is still there, like, wow, I'm not overlooked, but, you know, I felt like I almost, maybe I might have been overlooked. And you have to let that wear off. This grand prize was just fantastic. So we're letting go of this belief that somehow we're outside of God, you know, that we're separate, or that God has somehow overlooked us. We're letting go of all that. But that has this echo to it, so to speak. You know, really, it is still echoing within us. In fact, we've already let go of this, but the echoes are still reverberating. And so when we bring to mind the truth very clearly and look at those echoes and realize they're just echoes, that for a moment we take another look at the echoes and say, wow, that was really scary. Yeah, wasn't it? Yeah, it was. So when we're coming out of fear, there's sort of like this reverberation and echoes of fear. And our continuity is so used to fear, it tends to go back to it, or at least it wants to hear the echoes of it. And so we just hear the echoes are getting fainter and fainter. But as the echoes of fear get fainter, we also, we get a continuity, you know, upheaval. It's like, oh my gosh, I'm almost out of fear. It's so faint, I can hardly hear it anymore. And this is very intense. I'm experiencing this right now. It's just very intense. I can hardly locate fear anymore. I can't locate any cause for it. It's just absurd. And I I've been feeling this today very strongly, and then I sort of resolved it and how absurd it is, and I just had a good laugh, like, oh, I just relaxed. I suddenly just relaxed from the fear. So as fear gets fainter and fainter, we really have to manage this, because it's very, very intense. Fear is going to be gone forever, forever. We will see it's completely causeless, and we don't want to indulge in fear. Let's say it's like last call at the bar, closing and no more drinks, and you think, wow, no. Well, if you're not a drinker, but this is just sort of a classic analogy. Are the restaurants closing? No more food. And you think, wow, I'd really like to order another meal or another drink. But you say, no, I can't do that. I've got to get used to the fact that it's no more drinks are being served. I've got to get used to it. But so you decide, I'm not going to order another drink. But then that hits you hard. Oh my gosh, I can't rely upon that. I can't rely upon the food. Oh, it's over. And so you may have a very big upheaval about this. Fear is over. I just saw through the absurdity. I said, oh my gosh, it's absurd. There's no middle ground to find. I don't need to abide in any middle ground. The middle, Buddha said middle path. He didn't say middle ground. He didn't say abide in the middle ground. No, there is no middle ground. And so that takes away the excuse for seeking where to abide. You see, we delay by saying, well, sure, I want to abide, but where do I where do I abide? I'm looking for the right place to abide. There is no right place or wrong place to abide. There's only abidance. There's no where to abidance. There's no awareness, where, W-H-E-R-E-ness to it. There's no awareness to it. And so we know this, you see, we know it. Don't try to speed it up. The wow arises just from allowing yourself to feel the wow, your commitment to full stop. You say, I can handle this. And then it will come up. The clarity will arise because you're committed. So I'm going to give it the time and be patient enough with this. Now, I'm not going to freeze out here tonight. It's quite cool. This is the end of the storm, which is the air from up north. The cold air is then present, and it takes a while, the high pressure system to start building up some heat. It'll start, the temperature start rising as the wind has died down, but you know, it's chilly, and we're getting with daylight savings now, so we're getting close to spring, real close to spring, and that means we're getting real close to summer, right? And This year 2016 is a year of commitment. You have to commit. The pressure will push us one way or the other. And you'll either find yourself watching movies, or you'll find yourself practicing full stop in the wow, one or the other. Don't analyze what's going on. Just let it all stay as one ball of just wow, wowness. You say, this is intense. This is intense. The ocean's very intense. I'm feeling the intensity of it. Saying goodbye to fear. It's been our companion for so long. Saying goodbye to suffering. Saying goodbye to confusion. Saying goodbye to absurdity. It's been our companion for so long, we thought it was God. Which is why we're afraid to let go of it, because I think we let go of it, that we'll be in an abyss. No God. So this is part of the trepidation, part of the gradualist, absurdist concern and all this. But we know it's absurd, so just let it all be just one wow. Don't analyze it. There's nothing to analyze. We know the truth. We were asked in church to write our own obituary. This is our assignment. And I'm thinking, oh, what do I say about myself? I tried to accomplish something. And then suddenly it popped into my mind. It says, my obituary is going to read, he was resurrected from the dead. That's my obituary. And something told me, you got it. Exactly spot on. Yeah, I was thinking, well, what good can I say about myself? Be honest. And I said, why am I thinking about this nonsense? That's nonsense. He said, I just can't go with any of that. No. Just obituary says he was resurrected from the dead, and that's all that needs to be said. That says it all. So don't worry about your obituary. It's already written. I don't know why I'm having these interferences like this in this camera, but they're interesting. Colorful. Got an A+ in the class. The assignment got an A+, and the teacher says, you don't need this class anymore. That's the answer. You got it right. I mean, who would even think of saying such a thing? If you get an assignment in your classroom like that, you got to write your own obituary. Who's just going to say, "I was resurrected from the dead"? That's it. It just doesn't, but it popped into my mind that this is it. Because it's true. I said, this is true. This is true. This is my obituary. I already know what it is. So that's a pretty big wow right there. To accept that. You see, I accepted it. I said, okay, I know this is true, so why should I deny it? Anti-flicker. Maybe I should put anti-flicker on. Let me see what's going on here. NTSC. Let me put this on. See if I can stop this. No. What did I do? And now it just blanked out. Oh well. I can't see anything now. Oh, because the gain went down to zero. Okay. Can we get our gain back? Okay. There's our gain back. Our gain. Pow. Resurrected from the dead. There you go. Resurrected from the dead. Just like that. So what you do is you just accept this. This is true. This is true. This is my destiny. This is what is going to happen. This is my, and you accept it. And then this is just wow. You got to get used to it. You're no longer thinking about it or asking questions about it, pondering on it. Any of this, you just realize, yeah, there's no way around it. So why even bother trying to find a way around it? There's no definition of God. So why even try to find a way around this? That's just looking for a definition. There's no way around it. It's like riding. You ride a big wave, and you make it. And after, you just don't want to do anything. You just want to collapse, almost just lie there, just lie on your board or sit on your board and just for a while you don't want to do anything. 'Cause just wow, that was very intense, very, very intense. I made it through safely. Wow. I'm pretty good. I can do it. Wow. But you're not really quite ready to jump into another big one. You just. Sometimes the best thing to do is just come out of the water and walk up on the beach and just sit down on the beach, have something to eat, and just forget about the waves. Just forget about it for right now. Not even thinking of surfing, not even thinking about it. Just have some corn chips or something, and some sun chips. Drink some water. Don't need to say anything. Other people who saw you ride the wave, they know you don't need to say anything. They know you're just like you're in the wow of it. The surfers know. They're not gonna say, hey, what happened? How did you, what was your takeoff like? What were you thinking? What do you think? They don't pepper you with questions. That's stupid. Very disrespectful and unaware. You don't interview somebody. Because they know that you have to allow this to be, allow it to be, and accept that this is, you've done this. This is what you've done. You did this, and you have to accept this without analyzing it. It's already done. It's too late for analysis. There's no definition. It's too late for definition. You know, the wave did nothing to me. I rode the wave. It did not crush me at all. I'm untouched. It doesn't matter how close did it come to getting me. This is it. No, I'm untouched. That's a fact. It felt easy. It's a shock. When we succeed, it's a big shock. And so those who have succeeded, they understand that. It's a big shock. I thought I was going to fail. I thought I was going to fall. I thought I was going to be in trouble. I thought I was going to be suffering. No. It was easy. Easement. You know, they'll say, I can't believe I just did that. I just can't believe I just did that. I can't believe. Well, you have to believe it. So you got to give yourself time. You got to allow yourself to just keep on your mind. Said, yes, I did. I did do this. And insist on that. And don't try to get rid of this wow feeling by saying, oh, well, I'm not sure. And then start thinking about, you know, recalling not that, you know, was I, did I, the takeoff, do I remember how I took off? Well, I can't describe it exactly or define it. Well, maybe I didn't even do it. You know, you start casting doubt, casting shade on what you did. Don't cast any shade on it. Don't say, no, just say, I did it. I did it. And this, everything has to now align with that fact. This is a fact. This is fact. You see truth. It's fact. You see fact and say, this is fact. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. So then, and you just hold on to that no matter what. And it's very intense because all this whirl of spin is going on trying to drag you into it, and you refuse to be dragged into it. Someone's drag racing right there, you hear him? Seriously. They were just, don't be dragged into it. Refuse to be dragged into any spin. You temporarily it feels like you're on this little rock and all around you is this raging ocean, but you don't move from the rock. You just stay quiet there and don't move. Refuse to be intimidated. You see these huge waves coming towards you, saying, I'm not reacting at all. I'm not going to budge from here. Be very determined. There's nothing to find. And the wave will like come towards you, then it'll hit like a seawall, and the spray will shoot way up in the air like this. And Don't even flinch. Don't flinch. Don't move from the rock. Don't move from this steadiness, from the fact. The ocean of absurdity is just saying, look at the search I'm doing now. This search is really going to work. I'm going to get rid of this bad definition. It's been muddying the waters of my good definition. As soon as I get rid of this bad definition, this darkness, my good definition is going to shine. And everyone will realize, oh, yeah, this is God. I've been able to define God. Yeah, this is a massive wave coming towards you. Tidal wave. Don't flinch. Just imagine there's this huge tidal wave coming towards you and you're on this rock and you just don't move. It has to pass around you. It's trying, it's saying there's a way to encircle you with definition, and you just say the truth cannot be encircled with definition. So you just stay calm and steady. And then you eventually see the flatness of the tsunami. It's completely flat. From your perspective, you see it as it's absolutely flat. It's just a label. It's just a label of some imaginary definition. Just a label that we think is very powerful. So I enjoy this, but it's you talk about intensity. All these people, these posers, you know, go around doing daredevil stuff. They're just posers, okay. If you really want to dare, just full stop in the wow. Take that dare up and feel that intensity. And they'll go run off and say, no, I need to go climb El Capitan or something. You know, this is too scary. You know, I can't handle this. The precipice is just a label. It's flat. The pit is just a label. It's flat. It's just a definition. All definitions are completely flat. They do nothing. They have no meaning, actually. So if something arises, don't engage with it at all. Just say, okay, so this is some continuity fear here that I have to, there'll be some intensity. I have to just be patient and let this subside too. Because it's still arising, it means that I'm, you know, it has to subside. Ultimately, we see everything is flat. There's no arising nor subsiding taking place. It's only abidance. This is what the victorious ones are experiencing. is a perspective shift. The play of contrasting labels is finished. You realize there's no meaning in whatsoever. As soon as we think there's some meaning, suddenly it all has depth to us and takes on this drama and fearful drama-ness, terrifying drama-ness. But when we see it as flat, it's just, there's nothing to it at all. The monster, there's nothing to it anymore. It was a mere contrast of labels, which is completely meaningless. Now, seeing this is the all-at-once enlightenment, this perspective. It means all is equally flat. You see it is all equally flat. This is how it is right now. So there's nothing gradual that needs to happen at all. Jesus said nothing needs to happen. You don't need to do anything. So it's all at once flat. You see, this the perspective is all flat. The ocean is completely flat. It's completely still. Vision of stillness. Ram Maharshi, a vision of stillness. So there's nothing. It's not a product of contrast at all. It's just the realization contrast is meaningless. Completely meaningless. It's made up absurdity. It's attempt at definition. I was uploading some pictures to download and upload some pictures just so they're available to people of this great Tibetan master, 20th century Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro. And looking at the pictures, looking at him, oh my gosh. There's no question he's in this vision of stillness, vision of oneness. Very powerful. Similar to Ram Maharshi, those pictures are very powerful. So, I find them powerful, but maybe people want to ask questions, you know, so they want somebody to ask questions of. Isn't that possible? They want to analyze the wow. Is that what I gotta? I gotta find some definition here, you know. They think it's a lack of definition that is causing this fear. You know, if I just find the right one. This is an unrepentant mind. The repentant mind doesn't see it that way. They're honest. They say, no, that's not true. I have to suffer. Jesus says, you must, to follow me, you must carry your cross. This is what he's talking about. The cross is really the wow. This is the burden of a repentant mind, is there's no definition. There's no escaping from this this wowness. It just, you have to let it evaporate gradually. You have to be honest. There's no questions to ask about it. You know the truth about it. This is the cross. So we're carrying our cross here. This is very much what Jesus intends for us to, how to practice. Very much so. Same, you would same on any true Hindu path, Buddhist path, whatever path. It's very much what all these teachers intend us to practice, like this. So you might say we're students of all of them. You know, we're devotees of all these teachers, all of them. Interesting way of putting it. That I find it rather helpful to look at it like that. All teachers are my teachers. Ramana Maharshi said, the entire world was my guru. How about that? Great statement. I'm finding that more and more too. All teachers, what's your teacher? All teachers are my teacher. All victorious ones are my teachers. I am the student of all of them. Simultaneously. Because I'm doing exactly what they ask me to do. So you just do it as long as you can stand it. At some point, you feel, wow. Again, the image of you're sitting on this little rock, and yet all around you is this tremendous ocean. Tsunamis are coming, waves are coming. You know, just whirlpools. It's every possible thing is arising in this ocean, as far as tumultuousness, right? And you just don't flinch. You don't flinch. You're just practicing. Just, I'm not flinching. I'm not even putting my attention on anything. Here comes a tsunami. I'm not going to even put my attention on that. I'm just sitting here. That's all I'm doing. Whirlpool. Stormy seas. Interesting patterns in the ocean. Foam. Everything. No, I'm just taking no notice of any of it. Just sitting here. Absolutely steady. The rock is absolutely steady. No change is taking place in the rock whatsoever. Jesus said, build your house on a rock. Put your practicing on this rock, okay, of wow, full stop in the wow. The rock is this full stop. The wow is this turmoil, you know, in the ocean. There's just this ocean, okay, the ocean, there's this ocean of wowness. That's all. Just full stop. I'm just full stop here in this, sitting on the rock. Or you may be on the edge of this precipice. There's a rock. You're sitting there. All about you is this fog and clouds and the abyss there. Constantly changing rain. It's all these weather patterns. You're just not flinching. If your attention starts get dragged back into one, you just drop it all at once. No contrast. You're not going to contrast it with anything. Just full drop in the now. Full drop in the now. No process to follow. Those are just echoes of fear arising. So you hear meditation. Well, I don't want to make it more complex than it is right now. I mean, we're so intense already. We just stay in the intensity. It's so different. Like if you go into play basketball, you go into the gym, and you know there's always people, groups playing basketball. You get a big gym, there might be like one, two, four, six baskets maybe in a big gym, playing half court games kind of in their area, and you know you maybe sit in the sidelines and someone says, hey, you know, I gotta leave you. I need somebody to play. You want to play? You want to go? Okay, and then you're in the game, and you're playing against these people. You may not even know them. You know, it's a pickup game. Rec leagues are like that. There are a lot of very intense players in rec leagues. Ex-athletes, people just love the buzz of just basketball competition. It gets very intense there. I used to play in those pickup games for a while. But you find out there's some older people there that have been doing it for so long, and they're just like, you know, they're there to crush everybody. They say, I could have been an NBA player. Come on, you know, I mean, look how great I am, you know. And they're throwing elbows and you're getting fouled. I mean, it is really intense, actually. There's no referees. These gym rats who just, you know, they live for this. They just... I kind of like the beautiful game. I like the aesthetics of it. I like the flowing that I, you know, it's not like combat. Some of these guys, it's like combat. Anyway, but you go into this gym and you know it's going to be intense. If you're balling in the gym, you know, these guys are getting after it. Girls these days probably do it too. They may have their own pickup games. I don't know if they have rec leagues, and probably do. So that would be another analogy. It's probably very intense in there. They're playing. They're kind of saying, "Hey, look at me, coach. I should have been the star. You know, I've overlooked." So there's a lot of people in there that feel they've been overlooked. So they're trying to prove themselves, and. I could play with them. I could hang with it all, for sure. But I said, you know, you're going to get injured. And it's not that fun. It's like you're just trying to survive. it's like these waves are just, you know, crusher waves. It's not that fun. I'll go outside and shoot hoops. I shot hoops a lot. I just go to maybe a hoop that nobody's there. There might be some three or four people just shooting baskets, and I go do that. You know, that's fun, contemplative. But the atmosphere in the gym is intense. People are yelling, people are shouting, people are sweating. You know, it's very intense. So when you go through those doors, you know, it's the playtime is over. I mean, in terms of. You know, laziness is over. The intensity is there. So you have to have the guts to do that. When you get out in the ocean, if you're going surfing, the beach time is over. The intensity is there. And so you have to, you know, switch as they go on and just like, okay, this is exercise time. This is intensity time. Forget about everything else. When you're in the gym pickup games, you forget about the world entirely. When you get on a golf course, first tee, suddenly it hits you. It's just like, whoa, I'm in for it now. You know, putting, I'm not putting on the practice green anymore. This is a big shock. People get the jitters. I mean, there's nothing. You remember I used to go out the first tee at this Muni, and there'd be a big crowd of people there. I don't know why. Maybe they just like to see people mess up or something. Or they were waiting, maybe groups waiting, and it was your tee time, and there'd be three or four other groups that were waiting, or I don't know, but there's always these people hanging around. And you're getting on the first tee, and everybody's watching. What are they going to do? They're looking to see you. How nervous are you? Are you going to screw up? And invariably, I screw up, you know? It's like, wow. Because you realize I may have been on the putting green for an hour, chipping, putting, driving range, and think, okay, I'm ready. You get up to the first tee, and just suddenly your mind goes blank. You forget everything. And your heart's pounding. And you say, what am I doing? I don't know how to play golf. You say, help, you know, I just hope I'm lucky, you know, just. And sometimes you like try to like show how, you know, you try to overcompensate and say, okay guys, watch this, I'm just gonna hammer this one 300 yards, you're all gonna get a big thrill out of it, and don't worry, the boss is here. And you get up there, the adrenaline's pumping, you say, I'm just gonna hit this one so hard that all questions will be answered right now. And the people say, oh, the pro is here, you know. And when you do that, you end up missing the ball entirely, or like barely topping it to the ladies tee or something. And then people like, imagine the walk with all these golfers that are thinking like they're pretty, they're like really cool, and you know, they know how to do it. And you take a mighty swing and you top the ball, and it just rolls, and it rolls up like 15 yards to the ladies tee. And sitting there in the late, and then you have to put your club in your bag and you have to walk to the ladies tee and hit it again. You talk about your nerves just coming undone, because you know every single one of those guys is inside is just roaring with laughter. Yeah, they're just saying, what an idiot. Thank God that wasn't me. Thank God it was him and not me. And that's happened to me. You know, it's quite a few times that stuff happens on the first tee. It's horrible. And then the rest of the, you're mortified, and the rest of the round, you're just like jellyfish. You're jellyfish. You're ruined. So I get up the first tee now. People are kind of looking, you know. There's a dining area there outside, you know. There's a balcony. There's a putty. Everybody's kind of, oh, someone's on the tee. Oh, okay, let's kind of stop and let's see how they do. Let's put the pressure on them. You know, misery loves company. Let's project our pressure we're feeling onto them, right? So I walk out to the first tee. You know, what do? I pull out my 4-wood. Say, guys, you know, keep it easy, man. Keep it smooth. What are you guys grinding so much for here? What's the big deal anyway? You know, start out nice and easy here, folks. Then you just, you know, stand up, take a nice smooth backswing, whoosh, clip it, tight tee it low so you can't go underneath it and pop it up in any way. And you've got a fairway wood, so you just sweep it off the tee, keep it low, and just whack, you know, poof, sails out there. Oh, yeah, just put it in the bag. I'm not trying to prove anything here, folks. You know, that's the smooth move. And then some people say, ah, there's somebody who knows what they're doing, actually. Because they realize they got to manage their nerves here. They got to manage their nerves. And maybe in their mind they're saying, hey, you know, maybe I should do that. But they never do. But the good ones do, you see. You see, like, I played with those pros a while back that just really unglued me. But it was a great experience. And they stepped up to the tee from the back tees. Well, they pull out an iron. And I said, what are you doing with an iron? Are you crazy? Yeah, I just stepped up nice and smooth. Wham! And I said, well, if you would have hit driver, you could have driven it on the green. And they could have. But I said, iron. Because they know they're going to hit it right in the middle. Yeah, that's okay. You know, I'm not trying to smash it on the green off the first tee. They're smarter than that. They're smarter than that. So you come into practice and you say, hey, I'm going to get this really nice wow here. Okay? To start off with. I'm not going for the sudden enlightenment this instant. I mean, it's there, but I'm going to get a glimpse of it. I'm going to see it. But I'm not going to try to do too much because you'll come unglued. And there's nothing worse, like in golf, where you, the first drive, you just botch it and you hook it out of bounds. And then it just, you say, uh-oh, and you start to melt down. And then the next hole, you try to make up for it. Say, that's not me, you know. I mean, watch this one. And then you try to make up for it, you know, to erase from your mind and everybody else's mind that, I'm not some hacker who doesn't know what they're doing, you know. Watch, I'm going to hit this one, just dead straight, stripe at 300 yards, no problem. But watch this. You top it. Because you're looking up too soon to see how beautiful it was. Like, right. Oh, yeah, I'm going to watch this one. You top it. Now you're thinking, oh, my gosh, they think I just don't know how to play at all. The next tee, now the pressure's really on. And you're saying, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? You slice it out of bounds. And then it's like saying, wow, everything I've done, all the practice is just completely useless. It's worthless. I'm worthless. I'm an idiot. And then your whole game, it's a miserable, your whole game, it just goes to pieces and shambles. And you're just, you know, you're just thoroughly crushed. Thoroughly crushed. It happens to a lot of people on the golf course. It's very, very common, actually. It's why people dread playing golf and they quit. They don't mind practicing, but getting to that first tee is, that's why I don't practice anymore. I don't go to the driving range. I don't go to the putting green. I don't practice at all. I just get right out, step right up, because it gives you a false sense of a security. That's tempting to want to do it. But your mind is going to go blank anyway, and you might, you know, you should be conservative. Don't, if you're on the range, and I'm using this as an analogy for spiritual practice. If you're on the driving range and hitting your driver great, so I really got it worked out. You get to the first tee, you say, I can hit driver here. I figured it out on the range. I'm sure I can hit it. You know what? Every time I do that, something bad happens. Slice. I said, what the heck? I cured the slice on the driving range. Everything was fine. Now, because you revert back, when under duress, you revert back to old habits. So you get these new habits on the driving range. Oh, I got these new habits going. They vanish once you get on the course. They vanish. So why wear yourself out on the driving range, and why give yourself this false confidence? Just tell yourself, hey, I know how it's going to go here. So let's start off with a fairway wood off the first couple tees, the first couple holes, and let's play conservative. Let's take some bogeys. Let's let this round evolve, let it see how it goes, let it come to me, you know, and keep it smooth. The most important thing is keep it smooth. And the smoother you, the better you are at smoothing out your round, the easier it is next time. And as you keep doing that, gradually you'll be able to use your driver more and more. Okay, but you have to build up this smoothness of just overall smoothness with the whole experience. Doesn't matter, the results aren't that important. Do you have your little towel with you? You know, clean your club, clean the ball off. You get the, clean the ball off, you mark it clean. You take care of your business and everything's nice and clean and smooth. You miss the putt, tap in. You go back to your cart, everything's clean, everything's arranged properly. You have your smoothie there, protein smoothie. You write your score, you know how to do everything. Just keep it moving, keep it flowing, keep it smooth. Right? You'll hit some good shots, you'll hit some bad shots. You take it the same way, you know. You make a birdie, you know, hey, made a birdie, nice, okay. Take it up. Full stop in the wow. You know, just stay, keep it smooth. It's very important in golf to keep it, the same thing in spiritual practicing, to keep it smooth. Have a great insight, great. Wow, full stop in the wow. Have a great breakthrough, great. Full stop on the wow. It's the golfers that can do that that get really good. Those are the ones that get really good. You see the pros, they're just super great at it. Just one shot at a time. That's all they see, is just that one shot at a time, and nothing else matters. Doesn't matter what their score is or what's happening, nothing. They pay no attention to the scoreboard, nothing. It's just this shot, that's all. That's all that exists in their mind, it's just this shot. And when you can do that mentally, they're very mentally advanced, these pro golfers. When you can do that, you're going to play very well, actually. The same thing with spiritual practice. It's just right now, the wow right now is all that there is of the spiritual path. There's nothing more to it than this right now. What am I feeling right now in terms of the wow? I'm just feeling the wow. That's all there is to the spiritual path. There's no teachers, no master, there's no masters, there's no books, there's nothing else except just this wow. That's all there is to the path, and I'm just abiding in that. So I'm being successful. I'm managing very well. And this is getting close to abidance, right? We're honoring abidance by doing this. We're honoring that the fruit is ripe. We're taking the goal as the path, which is what they say, this the sudden enlightenment school. This is what they view it. They're taking the goal as the path. Abidance, this is honoring abidance. It's just abidance. And all labels are out the window. Really, you don't even think of it as abidance. You don't even have to label it conceptually, but we use just the wow. That's one label, that's it. All labels are rolled into just one, just wow. Now as we cool down, there can be some chit-chat. Let me sort of oscillate, a little spiritual chit-chat, then back to just, there are no labels. This is just it. This is the entire path right now. The entire path is just right here, right now. There's nothing else to look at. Just one shot at a time. I've never hit any other shot in my life, and I never will hit another shot in my life. It's just only this shot. There's nothing else. Just this shot. I just hit this shot. Wow. And at some point, oh. Okay, here's this shot to hit. This is the only shot now. The other ones are all gone. They say that the best pitchers in baseball have these short memories. In terms of just this pitch. Relief pitchers especially, you have to have a very short memory, and what you did yesterday, you don't even recall it. You don't even know there was a yesterday, actually. It's just now. So they live very much in the now. Athletes, really great athletes, have this mental toughness. They're able to do this. Tiger Woods was fantastic at that. One of the best ever. When he's looking at a putt, you can tell there's only this putt. There's nothing else. There's no past. There's no future. Completely in the now of just this putt. That's all there is in the world. There's nothing else. He's never done anything else. He's not thinking of what he's accomplished or what he will accomplish or anything. It's just, this putt is just, that's all there is. And he'd be looking at it. And you could tell he was, in his mind, he was really clearing his mind. He had very great powers of concentration. Unfortunately, he got messed up with a yoga girl, and that screwed it up for him. Because he felt he needed to. Because everybody else was getting married, you know, had their yoga girl, their blonde yoga girl. And he felt he needed to do that too and conform and everything. But because really he was just so locked into the golf, nothing else existed for him. And he felt, well, it's not a balanced life. You know, I need to have a kids and have a balanced life. Well, he wasn't really suited for that. His concentration was so superior. It wasn't suited for that. And then, you know, he found out he wasn't happy there and started messing around and things fell apart. And, you know, it's messed with his concentration. He's never been the same. He's never been the same. It's very unfortunate. He's actually a Buddhist. He probably in some previous life was a very great meditator, actually. And he just was using golf to help his meditation, help his nowness. I met him. He's a good guy. I liked him. He's not this terrible person. The media tried to make him out. He's horrible. No, he's not. He's not. He's just very focused. He made a point. There was huge crowds. He's walking past. And he made a point. He's walking by. He suddenly stopped and looked at me. And he just stopped. And I gave him my scorecard. He looked at me, smiled, and he signed my scorecard. I said, thanks. He said, sure. You know. And then he just walked on. I was the only person he signed for. I was the only person he signed. There's a throng, multitude. You know, it was pretty amazing. So I really appreciated it. It's just like, he must have known, like, you know, I've got his back. I have his back. It was one of the worst meltdowns I've ever seen. And I was a big fan of Tiger Woods. I had all his shirts and shoes and pants and hat, and you know, because he was awesome. Awesome golfer. Brought so many people into golf. And the best of all time, in my opinion, is when he was top of his game. You know, just the best ever. And what a buzz he put into it. Because we realized we're watching greatness, real greatness there, of mind, of his mind. His mind was so powerful. It's just amazing. So the pressure of culture, society, and women and everything is just like, hey, he's just horrible. He's a terrible person. Get rid of yourself. I got rid of everything. You know, I just completely had to just get rid of everything Tiger Woods. I even threw my scorecard away that he signed, you know. He became an anathema, you know. But in my heart, I still defended him. I said, look, you know, he'll bounce back. I kept believing he's going to come back. I was rooting for him. I still root for him. A lot of people still do. You know, hope he can come back. He's got all these injuries now and everything. But interesting, very interesting. I now wear Tiger Woods golf shoes, and nobody knows this. I didn't even know it. I just found these shoes. Holy Spirit said, look for these white golf shoes online. So I did. I found these white golf shoes, 9 and a half, my size, and the right price, and I said, I'm going to get these. Well, I didn't know it. They turned out to be Tiger Woods golf shoes. And the person who sold them to me, eBay, said, he said, these will be the most comfortable, best golf shoes you will ever wear. And I looked up, once I got them, I looked up and reviewed. I didn't really realize Tiger Woods golf shoes, but eventually it dawned upon me. People said, these are the best golf shoes ever made. And you know what? They're right. They are. They're awesome golf shoes. So, I may not wear my Tiger Woods hat anymore. You know, but it's still, you know, hey, say, hey, I'm wearing your shoes, man. Let me tell you. Because he was like a Zen master, basically, out there. He really was. He could make the ball do stuff with his mind, actually. His focus was so strong, he had psychokinetic powers, he really did. He could will the ball in the hole, putting-wise. If he needed to make a putt to win the U.S. Open, you knew he was going to make that putt. I don't care. You could count on it. And you see the ball, but you say, oh, it's not going to go in the hole. and he's just staring it down, and you know his will, his mental power is there, and the ball is going to break, and it's going to break, and it's going to break, and it's going to find some way to get in that hole. You just knew it. I've never seen anything like it in athletics, actually. When the chips were on the line, no one better. When the pressure was on, and it was just so amazing to watch. It was really a spiritual lesson, you know, it really was. One-pointedness. Nowness. He's completely in the now, completely one-pointed. And it was great theater. It was the best athletic theater I've ever seen, actually. I watched all his tournaments. It was great theater. And people just loved it. I mean, and just right now, you know, there's this, it's not the same. Jack Nicklaus was similar. I think Tiger Woods was a little better, actually, than Jack Nicklaus. The golf shows up, the mental focus. It reveals it, I think, more than anything. You know, you have to make this putt, and it's a 20-footer, downhill, side hill, you know, super fast, and you just have to make it. And the difference between making and missing is just this fine mental edge. You have to be so composed, and it just has to be so totally spot on, immaculate. You know, your mind has to be in this immaculate condition. And when you just absolutely pour it in, you know, it's just people just go, wow. Because they know, they say, I would have missed that one. Everybody watching says, I would have missed that one for sure. And because what? Lack of mental toughness, mental focus. I couldn't have pulled it together under these circumstances. You know, there's just so much writing on it. $1.5 million is writing upon it. You know, all this, you know, your tour card, you're getting into the master, everything's writing, the pressure is so intense. That's why you see these golfers, they melt down. And we're looking to see who melts down and who doesn't. And it's the one who has this incredible mental toughness, is, you know, they win. That's why Jack Nicklaus, he go into a tournament, he says, I know I'm going to win. I know these guys' minds. I'm tougher than they are. Same thing with Tiger Woods. He entered a tournament, he says, I'm here to win, folks. That's it. And you knew that he knew he was going to win this tournament. Because nobody was as mentally strong as he was. And, you know, women brought him down. The yoga girls brought him down. Chopped him up in pieces. He should have stayed single, you know? He should have stayed single. Yeah, so. And it's a lesson to all of us, you know? Wow. When they go after you, they really go after you, and you're demolished, you know? It's one of the saddest things I've ever seen. You see Tiger was out there and you realize that you could play better than him. He can't chip the ball. Well, when he was having trouble, he can't chip the ball. He can't pitch the ball. He can't putt it. I said, I could chip better than that. I mean, he's flying over the green with his chips. I said, what are you doing? Get the yips. He can't make the three-footers. It's just like astonishing. Astonishing to see this. But I understand. That's what happens. You lose your confidence. You lose your focus. You think everybody's talking about you. They're laughing at you. Can't handle your business with the women, huh? I mean, what's the matter with you? You know, they got the best of you. Ah, ha, ha, ha. You know, they're going to say, oh, that could be me, you know. They people project their own insecurities onto these stars, right? They love to see him fail. They love to see him fall. Right? That's one of the big sports in the world, watching, building people up and watching them fall. People love to watch that, you know. I don't. I love to see him not fall. So, you know, Tiger, we got your back, you know. The people who count gotta have your back, you know. We don't want to see you fall. And in our eyes, you haven't fallen. Keep that in mind. I don't want to say this to everybody. In my eyes, no one has fallen, actually. This is something we need to do. I'm using Tiger Woods as an example. Because we're all world beaters, actually. We're all in this fallen state. We think we've really fallen. But really, nobody's fallen. Nobody's fallen. But we can just use this. This is a great example. This is one of the most amazing examples that there is. Is Tiger Woods fall from grace? I'm saying no, you haven't fallen at all. In my eyes, you pretended to fall. You went to this dance with the yoga girls of falling. Okay, but you haven't really fallen at all. You know, you got into, maybe I need to define what I'm doing. He felt this pressure to define, you know, what he's doing. And this is what got to him, really. And then that's what led to the womanizing and all this other stuff. Is people say, Tiger, you're so great. Explain it. Be human. You know, they really, he was put under so much pressure. Stop being so robotic. Be human. Be human, meaning be like the rest of us failures, you know. And he held it together for so long, you know, he's like almost inhuman the way he was, really. We said he's not human. I mean, who can do this? He's so dominant, it was just incredible. It's so difficult. But you know, he just quick answers to the press, you know, just not really relating with anybody, just because he kept his focus, his mental focus. He's like Barry Bonds, the same way. Another one falling from grace so badly. He just brushed everybody off because he said, look, I got to keep my mental focus razor sharp. I'm the greatest. I don't have anything to say about it. I don't need to explain it to anybody. And as long as he did that, you know, his fall came after he retired, actually. Or he's now like an anathema, an outcast. It's another sad thing. I had his back, too. I understood what he was about. He just had this focus. He just stayed in the zone. I'm not explaining to anyone. I'm not telling, no. No definition of what I'm doing. So I would say to Tiger Woods, he's just in the wow. He needs to realize, I'm just experiencing this tremendous wow of what I did. And just then full stop in that wow. And then it will come back. It will come back. It's not gone. It's not gone anywhere. He just decided, you know, he didn't realize the wow of it hit him at some point. It was so strong. He needed to, he thought, oh, I need help. I need help with this. I need to do this. You go tumbling off into absurdity. But as soon as you realize, oh, this is just a huge spiritual wow. And just practice meditation, full stop in the wow. You'll recenter yourself and say, hey, it's okay to play that well. I'm fine with that, actually. I don't need to explain anything. Because those who really count, those that I'm doing this for, don't need any explanation. The unrepentant ones, no amount of explanation will ever suffice for absurdity. Absurdity will never be satisfied with any explanation. And those who have repented, those who really count, they don't need any explanation. So why am I trying to explain? Get the yoga girls, help me explain. Loosen me up. Come on, Tiger, be more human. Come on. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, Tiger, come on. We want you to explain to us, relate to us. How are you doing this? You know, what is it? Just explain. Now he got caught up with the unrepentant folks, trying to please them. Forget it. You can't please everybody in this world. You'll never please absurdity. Those who are still worshiping and believing absurdity as God, they'll never please them. They'll never get it. As long as they're that way, they won't get it. But those who have repented, they don't need any explanation. They're seeing it. I remember standing close to Tiger Woods, teeing off, hit the ball past my head, and it was just like seared in my brain, the sound of the golf ball. It's like, whoa. And he just walks past me. He walked past me a number of times. He just walks right by me. He's playing. And it's like, nothing exists. I was looking at Tiger, you look at me. He wasn't seeing anybody. He wasn't seeing anyone. He was completely in his own world of right now. It's very impressive. It was awesome to experience that. So thank you, Tiger Woods, man. You help people out more than you realize. Because that was an attention getter. He said, hey, wait a minute, you know. You don't have to play the game of this world necessarily. And actually, I said, you know, I could have been Tiger Woods. I could have been. Any one of us can be. If I would have picked up golf at an early age and my eyes hadn't gone bad, you know, I said, you know, I could also have played this way. I said, I'm sure of it. No question about it. The concentration was there. The concentration was there. But that wasn't my role. That wasn't my, you know, destiny to do that. But I understand. I understand the focus, the concentration. Like I used to in putting, I used to say, I used to walk up to the putt. It didn't matter to me how long the putt was at all, whether it was 3 feet or 100 feet. It made no difference to me whatsoever. I said, this one's going in. I already know it's going in. It's, to me, I'm not going to miss. There's no way I'm missing this. It's going in. And I'll make a 100-footer the same way I make as a 3-footer. And when I make a 100-footer, I just, you know, shrug. It was nothing. It didn't matter. It made no difference. Because mentally, it was the same. It was all the same. I was an extremely good putter when I was young. Especially long putts that people think difficult putts. For me, there's no difficulty. There's no difficulty. So when I saw Tiger Woods make those putts, I said, yeah, I know you're going to make it. There's no doubt about it, you're making that putt. It's easy. What's the difficulty? There's no difficulty. He'd make the putt, he'd pick it up. Yeah, you know, what's the big deal? It's no big deal. It's the same. It's all the same. In my mind, I've already made the putt. It's already in the hole. It's already made it. So what I do physically is just a reenactment of what's already happened in my mind. This is how he played golf. It's already happened in my mind. I'm just reenacting it for everybody. It's just a reenactment, actually. In fact, this whole world is just reenactment, is all we're doing. Everything has already happened in our mind. Everything is just a reenactment. This is a fact. This is why people can know what's going to happen. I had this precognition, because I was in the zone of intention in mind. So I knew what was going to happen because it's already happened in the mind. And I said, well, this is what's going to happen. Then it happened just exactly like that. So, well, it's just a reenactment. We're just acting out what has already happened in our mind. And there's a delay of certain delays of day, 2 days, a week, you know, whatever. There's various delays, factors. But then I just say, huh? What's the big deal? Oh, how did you know that? What do you mean, how I know that? It's just a reenactment. You're just doing a reenactment of what's already happened. So this world has already happened, actually. As we're sitting, this has already happened. We're just reenacting what is, you know, reenacting it out of absurdity. Yeah, really. These golf shoes are the best shoes by such a large margin. It's amazing. I mean, there's nothing that even touches them. It's amazing. Maybe I better find another pair. They don't make them anymore. People say that, and subsequent models are not nearly as good. You know, they just nailed it on these shoes. They just got everything right. It's amazing. Wow, I can hardly believe it, you know. And that's what the reviews, people say that. They say, wow, these golf shoes, they just got everything right. I used to wear Tiger Woods golf shoes, absolutely. Whatever the new golf shoes he had, if I could get them, I'd get them. You know, dressed like him, and you know, carry yourself, you know, with confidence out there and everything is very, very inspirational. But eventually, it started getting to him, what the frustration of people, you know. He felt maybe they weren't getting it, and he needed to explain it to them. And that's when the frustration started building up. He said, "I got to play better. They're just not getting it." And then he started cursing and yelling and started having meltdowns on the course. You know, he didn't used to do that. So he was frustrated. You know, it's like, wow. And maybe he just needs to say, hey, you know, give people time to catch up to the wow of it all. You know, I've done what I needed to do. And now I can focus on meditation. Yeah, don't really need to prove anything. Don't need to prove anything more. It's already been done. It's already been done. There are some guys that are pretty good now, but not quite like that, no. Rory McIlroy, when he's in the zone, he can be that way. Nonchalant. He's playing out of his mind, but it's just no big deal. You know, just I already know in my mind that this is how I play. And so just a reenactment here, folks. Very confident. When he gets on a roll like that, he's very impressive. Jordan Spieth also very impressive, especially putting wise. It's like this is going in, you know, this is going in, no doubt about it. When he needs to do something, he's very good at doing it. Very mentally tough. These players, those two players, are very mentally strong. Super confident in their minds. They know, already know what's going to happen. So spiritually, we already know what's going to happen. We're enlightened. Okay, we already know what's going to happen. And we're just not explaining it. We don't need to explain it. What do we need to explain it? To what? To absurdity? That's it. Only absurdity is demanding an explanation. Because no explanation will ever suffice for absurdity. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Let those who think they're humans take care of humanity. Let those who believe in humanity take care of humanity. This is what he's saying. We're not. Jesus said, I didn't come for them. I came for sinners. In other words, those who recognized absurdity, their suffering, and have repented. I came for those who are repented. They know they're in this absurdity. They're trying to define God. That's what a sinner is someone who's trying to define God. He said, I came for those who are aware of this, that they're sinning. They're trying to define God, and God cannot be defined. I didn't come for the ones, the righteous ones, the self-righteous ones. I didn't know. I didn't come for those. Because he said, I know that it's useless. You cannot, there's nothing you can say. Because absurdity will never be satisfied with any explanation at all. It will still be completely insecure. Because it says, I need a definition to exist. I need a definition to exist. I can't find one. I can't find one. It keeps eluding me. It's Absurdity is the notion that existence, our existence, is predicated on defining God. So that's completely insecure premise from the very get-go. It's a completely insecure premise. It will always be an insecure premise. And nothing you can do about that exists except drop this absurdity of trying to define God. That's it. Nothing else to do. So they're trying to find the right definition. There's nothing you can say that will help them at all with that. So Jesus is clear. He came for those who recognize they're sinners. They're trying to do the impossible, and therefore they must repent. He came for those. So there's no explanation. There's nothing to be said. There's no definition. And there's no explaining why there's no definition. It just is the way it is. We're because of perfect freedom. Perfect freedom is perfect freedom. There's no need to explain. You know, perfect freedom is not predicated upon some explanation, upon some definition of itself. It is the way it is. Now, in talking here, you seem to be giving some explanation, but you're just kind of just using your reassurance more than explanation, actually. It's not really an explanation, it's just reassurance that no explanation is needed and it's okay. There isn't any explanation. You can't explain reality because there's no definition of reality at all, really. We say you use the term freedom, but that doesn't really mean anything. I mean, that's not it. It's absolute, perfect, pure freedom right now. Always, right? Just right now. This Jesus says it's beyond anything we can imagine or conceive in imagination. So we understand that words are just this reassurance. It's just a reassurance. It's not an explanation, really. So just be quiet. Just be still. Full stop in the wow, where there's no attempt to define anything. Just practice is not attempting to define anything at all. No definitions of enlightenment. Don't try to define enlightenment either. I'm getting pretty cold. I don't want to get too chilled here. So I've enjoyed this video greatly. It's been really intense. And so manage that intensity, manage the wow, and don't try to overdo anything. I may even go eat something now, yeah, it's possible, right? Some Sun Chips with Cheese Whiz. If you want to eat, you know, go off your diet, just get some Cheese Whiz on a chip, you know, and say, I'm really... There's some junk food there. I'll just have a little bit of junk food. Okay, go all in. Cheese Whiz. How long can Cheese Whiz last in the fridge? Has anyone ever found it? Is it ever expired? I mean, has mold ever grown on it? I mean, does it ever get old? I don't know. I don't think so. I don't think there's anything that can grow it. I don't think any mold can grow on Cheese Whiz. I don't even want to know what's in there. Is it plastic or what? What is it? I don't know. There's certain things. I mean, honey's nice, and nothing, you know, nothing grows bad in honey. I don't think it can last and last and last and last and last. And vinegar, I like vinegar too. Vinegar stays very stable, right? You can just have a bottle of vinegar there in the room forever, I think. Some honey, some vinegar, and some Cheese Whiz. You're good to go. Always have something to eat. You know, if you want to be a survivalist, just stock up on Cheese Whiz. It'll last forever, and you open it one up, nothing bad will happen to it. Vinegar, honey, and cheese whiz. You're ready for the apocalypse. You can find anything. You're looking for grubs, just get a grub and dip it in the cheese whiz. Tastes good. Nice tasting cricket there. Nice tasting worm. So if you worry about starvation, just get a lot of cheese whiz. And you can just put that on anything. You can put it on dirt, whatever you need to eat, leaves, it's and helps it go down. Put a little bit of honey on it too, some vinegar, a little bit of vinegar, a little bit of honey. Saute the ants, whatever bugs you can find. I don't know what you can find, whatever you dug up or found, and cockroaches or something. Saute the cockroaches in the vinegar, and then put some cheese whiz on them and some honey to help wash it down. And, that's good. It's very good. they won't spoil, you see. I mean, you see that there you go. You get some for survivalist advice for those of you who are worried about the apocalypse. That's some good advice right there, isn't it? I eat a lot of it. A lot. It's one of my favorite foods. On salad, I just drench it in vinegar. At the end, there's like in the bottom of the bowl, there's just like a whole half a glass of vinegar, almost an oil and vinegar. I just drink it down. It's like, instant health. Just look out for the apple cider vinegar. It's too intense. You drink too much of that down and too much of a good thing. But it's very healthy, apple cider vinegar, actually. Very, very healthy. Maybe it's a natural antibiotic. Probably drink that and just kills all the bacteria. Maybe it kills all the good bacteria too. I don't know. Oh, the refrigerator's out. No electricity. How are we going to survive? Well, cheese whiz is okay. It's still okay, I think. Marshmallows, too. Make sure you have plenty of marshmallows. I don't think anything affects the marshmallows. There you go. We're getting a nice, good idea of how to survive. Marshmallows, cheese whiz, honey, and vinegar so far. Chocolate's pretty good too, right? Chocolate, yeah. Twinkies. I think Twinkies last a long time. Okay, so that's it. I'm freezing out here. That's it. Time to wrap this one up. Very great. That's it for this one.